Hey guys, so today I'm going to be putting mechanical fret switches into a Les Paul for 360. Originally, I was just going to do a very quick video about putting switches in with the stock frets. And then I'm like, you know what, I think it'll look a little bit cooler with the faceplate that I bought for it to use solid color frets. And I was like, well, solid color frets, SG frets. They seem to fit really well, but they have these two tabs on either side that kind of get in the way. So I got to removing them all. It was pretty easy. I just cut, you know, them all off with my little wire cutters there. And I got to the blue fret, and it wasn't fitting too well. It was giving me some problems. I took it to the belt sander. I tried shaving some stuff off. It just still was giving me trouble. And so I figured ditch it. Go back to my drawer with all my frets. I open it up. I grab a blue fret. I throw it in there. I'm like, oh, this is different. It's not third party, though, but it's different. And I'm like, oh, it's from a wireless PlayStation 2 guitar by Red Octane, you know, the white ones. And I was like, this fits awesome. So I rummage through my drawer. I find a full set of those fret buttons. And I was really happy, so I ditched the whole, like, idea of cutting up the SG buttons, which in the end wound up being a much better decision. Really more that it was just luck that I had them. Because they fit literally the same as just a standard, you know, Les Paul fret. And so once I did that, I figured we'll get those in there, we'll measure it all up, and then we'll take it to the mill. I really don't show the measuring part because I don't have a good camera angle on how I do it, but let's just say I found out it was 75 thousandths that I needed to take off of each of the frets. So, you know, that's basically what it wound up being. Yeah, look at how nice that looks. Alright, so let's get to the mill now. So I start by bringing down the quill. I take this guy here, and I bring it down. So that goes up and down. So, you know, I come from up, go back down. And what I do is I just barely kiss the part until I see a little bit of plastic there, you know? You see some debris coming off, and I know that that's where I need to stop. That's my zero mark. So I come over here, and I zero out my, you know, my up and down, which is the z-axis, and I know that 75 thou that I had to go. That's 0.075, and I just look out for that number there. If I go anything over that, I'm going to probably ruin it, and then I'd have to modify the board a little bit and the guitar itself. So here, I'm just going to go in small increments till I hit that. Normally, I have to go close to 200, like 170 to 180, and I will do that in steps. I'll do like 100 and go around, and then I'll do another, you know, and go around. But this is only 75, so I just did it in one go, making sure I blasted the air so I can see clearly, you know, throughout the way. Now what I do is, even though I don't have to do it, you know, perfectly, I just kind of go around the whole outside perimeter of the fret. My cutter is big enough to do the middle as well while I'm doing that, so I don't have to worry about anything in the middle. And if I do the outside perimeter, that guarantees that the sides of the switches aren't going to get caught. Because that was one of the things that I had the very first guitar that I made. I just only ever cut out for the switch, you know, actuator itself. And then I was like, oh, it doesn't work. But I'd never realized that it was touching the switch body. So I make sure now that I go around the whole thing so the switch body has no chance of getting caught up in the fret itself. Here I'm lowering the table a lot because usually I don't like to start with the table very high. After like 2-3 runs of this, I clean everything up. You know, I make it all nice and new. I blow it all off, sweep it, whatever. But I also bring the table back down quite a bit. And then I start, you know, because every time I go up 75 or whatever, here you'll see that the fret button, you know, fits. I check them all when I'm doing them. I put each one in as I do it, even though I'm pretty confident that number I chose is really good. You know. So we're onto the red fret now. And same thing, it's going to be, you know, just the same thing over and over. But what's nice is that I can explain why I'm doing one fret at a time. The reason why I do one fret at a time is it's nice and centered to the jaw. Even though the jaws are pretty parallel, being centered is just nice. That when I go down with the quill or come up with the table, I can't go through the fret to the other part. I have to lift back up or lower back down, and that would just reset all my numbers again and kind of make it, you know, void. And also, I cannot squeeze the part in the vise. So if I have many parts across the whole vise, again, even though it's parallel, some may not be as tight as others. And if you tighten it too much, you'll deform the part. And if you deform the part, then you're not making it fully flush and parallel to the cutter. Now I'm not really cutting what I need to be, and I could break the part. It could come flying out and hurt me and all that. And you'll see, I didn't mention it, but I always wear safety glasses in the mill. I wear safety glasses when using my Dremel and cutter. I usually don't when I'm soldering, although I should. My face gets pretty close to molten, you know, metal. It does kind of pop sometimes. So you always be safe, always be careful. Even if you don't have the type of machinery that I do, literally, if you're using a drill, just wear some protection, you know. You'll see here I kind of blow it with my mouth a little bit because I don't have three hands to use, you know, go the Y-axis and the X-axis at the same time, because it's kind of like an Etch-a-Sketch in a way. I don't have a CNC. This is an old mill, and it's all done by hand. So I'm basically, like I said, on an Etch-a-Sketch, and I'm going side to side, back and forth, and doing all that. So yeah, and you'll see I blow off all the frets. There's a lot of debris inside, and usually I'll take a razor blade and I'll cut some of that debris off because it gets stuck to it, and that just hollows it out a little bit more. And here's me probably just, oh, I guess I already tested that it fit. Yellow fret. The yellow fret, sometimes I'll make a little bit different just because it is the middle of the body. But usually I don't have to modify the back of the neck. So, yeah. Oh, and I also changed camera angles. Nice. I was actually hoping for that. That there would be something a little bit closer here. So I could show that there's like just a little bit of a lip on the inside. And also that I said the cutter's big enough where when I go around it, I'm getting the middle of it as well. I'm just using a standard high-speed steel cutter for anybody who knows or is interested. It's nothing fancy. I didn't need anything. You know, I think it was like $12. Even though I have a lot of cutters around here, I figured I'm doing these projects. I should probably, you know, buy something specifically for it. And that's what I'm talking about. The little extra bits that are stuck inside. There's one in the hole and the little bit next to it. I'll take a razor blade and pick that out and then cut the side off of it off. I most likely do that off camera, though, just because it's kind of trivial. It doesn't have to be done. And to take up the space to record it, this is not worth it. You will notice, though, if I had a SG fret, that, like, if you look back, that the SG frets actually have a little bit raised center. This does not, which kind of brings up the whole, it's pretty much in a Les Paul fret. Now, with that being said, I do want to try putting some Les Paul frets into one of these guitars one day. That'd be kind of cool. A PlayStation 2 guitar, wireless. That's not... Oh, you know what? That's weird. I say it's the only official wireless guitar for PlayStation. I'm wrong. The Kramer was wireless and, in a way, more official because it came with Guitar Hero 3. So I take that back before anybody wants to comment. Yeah, the Kramer is a really good guitar. I see a lot of people do Arduino mods to them these days. Just because they're nice. And they have a pretty thick neck. Don't take that out of context, please. Alright, so now we're on to the orange fret. And then we're going to be able to wire this thing up. And you can see here, even though I have a protector over my readout, you'll see the numbers always constantly moving when... Oh, and there, I didn't take the tabs off. It's another thing just to mention more to myself, but I'm saying it because it is a thing. I have to take the rubber tabs off the frets so I can make sure it sits parallel with the jaws. And also, if you're wondering why there's tape on it, because I didn't mention that, the tape is there just more to protect the plastic. It doesn't get, you know, gall or anything. Because you never know, a chip could fall in between the two, and then if it gets on the steel is, that's like hardened, like stainless steel, you know. So if that gets a piece of, like a chip on it, when you go to tighten the plastic, it's just going to go right into it. Kind of like a press. It's just going to destroy whatever you have. So it's good just to not do that, you know, or good rather to put tape or something protecting when I'm doing plastic. And any soft metal, like I do a little bit of copper and stuff, is very soft and it's just nice to have some protecting layer. All right, so we're done with the orange fret now. We'll put them all in. I'll get the board snapped in there, and then I'll see how they all fit. At that point, there was no orange switch. Like, there was no switch on the orange fret. I took it off so I could measure it, you know, better. But I saw that the first four were really good. They fit well. There was no play. The switch was right on it. You know, it wasn't actuating the switch early. But, yeah, it looks good. And on to putting it back together. Before I started hardwiring the neck, I put a little lock screw in this, flip switch for taking the neck off. I just do that so, you know, I used to put stickers on it to cover it, but I learned, you know, just put a little screw in there, and that'll prevent it from, you know, letting the neck come off. I also replaced the whammy, just the whammy bar itself. If you see, and you'll see better when I compare it to the other one, but this one, it's just really jacked up. So I replaced it with one from an SG, which is a little shorter, but I think it turned out well, and I actually kind of prefer it being a little more stubby. And if you look at that spring being, 15 years old, is still just brand new looking, not a little bit of rust or corrosion or anything on that. So yeah, I did that, you know, a little bit of stuff here and there, and then I start wiring up the body part of it. Yeah, there's me talking about the whammy itself. There's me just verifying the numbers. I do this a lot, but I still, you know, verify. And then I usually, what I'm doing here is I'm cutting out the neck, and I'll cut out the body in a little bit here. So the cable can fit through. Instead of having the plug there, you have a cable instead because it's hardwired, you know. So I just get rid of all this. You know, the reason why I have to do this commentary is I was watching Workaholics while I did this, and it was a little loud, and, you know, not on top of, I was talking through it, you know, doing the same thing, explaining what I'm doing, but it just was kind of poor production on my part. Generally, when I'm working, I'm either watching movies or TV shows on my Xbox 360. So yeah, I gotta stop doing that, I guess. Here, I think I'm just taking it out so it's easier to solder. You don't see here because my fat head got in the way, but I cut the ribbon off, and next time I'm not gonna do that. I usually do, but I figured if I just pull on the ribbon while I'm trying to desolder it, I can actually pull the cable through, like the wires through, and I don't have these like frayed just strands of wire in my solder joints. And here I'm stripping my ribbon cable. I got this ribbon cable from work. It's like 300 feet. I've used a lot of it though. And so I strip it. I cut each individual wire, you know, so I can split them of the ribbon. Then I strip those wires. And in a second here, you'll see I do this thing. It's called tinning. And basically, you're just pre-soldering the wire so that when you go to solder it, it mates really well with your solder. Because if you just have a dry wire and you touch it with solder onto a joint and you go to solder it, it's called a dry solder. Or like a dry weld. Or no, sorry, cold weld. It'll be a cold solder. And when you get a cold solder, there's not an actual real connection. Even though it's touching and it may make a connection, it's not physically like welded together. So you just run your tip and some solder through them. Just coming up here in a sec. So you'll see I just barely touch and then get that. I do each one of these individually. And generally, you don't have to, but I twist the strands together. I don't like using solid wire, especially for, you know, tiny gauge wire. I don't know if they make solid, but I just don't like it. So the stranded, you know, is nice. And then what I do is I usually snip off the ends. I'll strip back like a quarter inch, and then I'll cut way less. I'll use like a 16th of an inch final, you know. It's just easier to strip back a good amount. and then like tin your wire and then cut it. You know, you could strip it really small and tin it, but it's just easier this way. So here's me. I think I cut some of this out because my head gets in the way again, but I just solder this all to the main board. Oh, and I changed cameras as well. So now I'm cutting out one of the screw anchors because that just gets in the way, and I wasn't going to use it anyways. And I do believe I'm surprised I didn't cut the rest of the slot out for the cable, but maybe I do that in a second. Yeah, there's me finishing soldering that. Then just the two screws, you know, they go back into place. And as a rule of thumb, after you tighten everything down, even before you finish tightening it, and you just get it nice and secure, you want to feel the buttons again. Press them, make sure the silicone pads inside are where they need to be, and that they're pressing, you know. You can't really test that they're working until you turn it back on, but you can at least, you'll see here, like I'm doing, I'm making sure that when I press the button, it gives me the tactile feedback that I need, and it, you know, it feels the way it's supposed to. It doesn't feel like it's stuck or anything. Oh, and here's where I cut the other section out. This was actually kind of weird because what I had to do, since I couldn't cut sideways, is I cut the two, like, cross, you know, horizontal, and then I just took the cutter and just went back and forth, kind of like a cutter, like on my mill, and I just cut out all the plastic for it. And then here, same thing as before, cut it to length. I cut it a little short, to be honest. I could have added another whole inch, but because the neck doesn't remove, it doesn't really bother me too much. And yeah, tin all the wires and cut them back. And I'm now again verifying that one is brown. I try to make brown one all the time for these. So there's consistency, but it's also easier for me to remember. And then the nicest and also easiest part, I feel, I pre-tinned the contacts on the HobbyCNC board here. And then I just touch my tip with a little bit of solder, and it flows so well and it gets in there. I really like working with these boards. Some people complain about them, but honestly, I really love them. I think for how I'm doing it with the mill, these boards are just incredible. And I kind of went against buying some with switches because it's $9. It's like $10 for a board without, and it's $20 a board with. But it's been pretty difficult to get switches lately. Like, I ordered the blues, even though I don't want to use them now because they're too, you know, soft. They don't have any real resistance on them. But, like, it took a freaking month from when I ordered it to get here. So it seems kind of hard to get switches. So I've been just ordering boards with switches again. Hopefully one day I can strike up a deal with the guy and be like, hey, can I pay like a dollar less or something since I buy so many of these things? Or something, you know. I don't mind it. It's just that when I do happen to sell things, all the prices that I pay up front reflect the price that I pay, or the price that I have to charge, rather. Oh, all right. So we're here, still soldering this. I could have sped this part up, but I guess because I zoomed in, I wanted it to be seen, even though I need to get a better angle going. But yeah, that's done being soldered. I sometimes use the molded in a, you know, like wire holders there, but I also sometimes don't. All right, now let's put the guitar back together. I'm pretty sure that's what I do next. I'm putting it back on prematurely because I still have to put the faceplate on. Oh, you know what I'm doing? I'm actually testing that I wired the frets up right. Even though I don't like second guessing myself, before you close anything up, you really should make sure it works. So here I think I hit the guide button, and I'm making sure that the buttons work. What's cool on 360 is I think all the buttons work on the the dashboard, or the guide menu, I guess. Blue signs you in or signs you out. Yellow takes you home. Orange is LB, so it just goes left for the tabs. And then green and red, you know, obviously A and B. So it looked like it tested out well, which, again, I knew it would, but you still have to check it. Because you know what? The one time you don't check it, what's going to happen is that's going to be the one time that it doesn't work. Like, the one time you say, hey, I've done 1,000 of these. I've checked every single one, but I'm not going to check this one. Just by sheer luck, that's going to be the one that messes up. So it's good practice on anything that you just double check your work. And here, I can already tell you that I'm doing this wrong. I have the screws still in the back of the neck, and it's not the right way to do it. You have to pretty much line them up 100% perfectly when you do this. And it's way easier just to take all the screws out, put the body in, or the back, rather. I always say body, because to me, it's all plastic body, you know. But yeah, once I take the screws out, it becomes a lot easier to work on. And I think I'm looking for my... I should have cut this part out, but oh well. I'm looking for my bit right now. Yep, there I go. I flip it over. That gets all the screws out. I mean, pretty self-explanatory there. But if you look, it's so much easier just to snap this thing on if I take the screws out. And you also want to note, too, when you're putting a screw in, if there's any resistance or any, like, it feels hard or anything, stop what you're doing. You could be on a cable. You could be cross-threading. Everything should be really easy and simple and shouldn't take much force or effort. Especially with these things being so old, those threads are more than locked into that plastic. The only thing I found is because they're kind of coarse thread, using an electric driver, you know, like one of those mini board drivers, it doesn't work too well. I bought one to use on it, and getting the body apart with it doesn't work too well. Doing the inside components is kind of easy, but, you know. And I mentioned that the inside was already cut out for a different guitar that had a similar mod. The back that I originally took off this body wound up not going back on it because I was missing the plug for the battery. It had a bunch of stickers on the back, and the battery cover itself, like the way that it fit, it didn't fit like flush to the back. So I just had another back laying around. And what's cool is it might be a PS3 back. You'll never really know. I don't know if the serial number or anything shows, but to me, the backs on 360 and PS3 and 360 are all the same. There's slight differences in, like, model types, or, like, maybe baseline types, I don't know, or subcategory, whatever you want to call it. You have your Les Pauls, and then you have your few different variants inside of that genre. Just like the Explorers have a few different ones of that. Alright, so now we are done, you know, put it all together, and we're going to test it. Fix that. But that's just a board swap, so there's no use in showing it. I'm not gonna do it right now anyway.
I'd say the intro is harder than the solo, but all in all, I'm pretty consistent on getting it. I'd expect, even though I haven't played this song in a few years, I've probably played it over 100 times. Try to pull a fast one on me at that ending. But again, I played it enough to know. And I like how I use Bret Michaels as the singer in this one. Cool. Well, yeah, honestly, the guitar... I mean, come on, I didn't do much. The point that I wanted to drive home was that the frets are just the same as if I were to use the stock Les Paul frets and mill them out for the mechanical. But the cool thing is because they fit so well in the slot, like in the hole itself, I didn't care the depth, because I was modifying that anyways. And I think, hopefully I showed earlier, but if not, I want to re-drive home a little bit. When I make these things, I make them to where... Here, let me exit the game. Oh, you know what? That's kind of embarrassing. I got, not by a little bit, but by a lot, a better score. Messing around, not having, you know, having this auto-activate versus actually trying to activate in certain spots. My path must have not been good, or I must have just been messing around. Regardless, let's get back to the guitar. So yeah, so what I try to do is I try to make it to where the frets sit equally as flush as they always did. That they don't fall down, and that the travel is equal to how much I've taken out. I guess I don't know how to explain it any other way other than just the fret is sitting exactly on the switch. So when you press it, you're not getting any slop, any play, you're just getting the switch and that's it. It's just a product of the switch itself, is that it's low profile enough where the stroke of the switch is the height of the fret here to there. So it kind of goes a little bit down, but almost flush. Like when I put my fingers on it, it's flush with the body, or the neck rather, but you know what I'm saying. Yeah, you know, like I said, I push for it to be store-bought, because if I ever do sell these things, I want people to be like, hey, this feels like I bought it at a store. That being said, everything's always for sale. I don't know if I want to sell this one, but everything's always for sale. I just like how it turned out. So yeah, so I told myself that this faceplate would be for a guitar that would be unmolested and not modified in any way. And, I was gonna put mechanical frets in it, but to me that's not... I mean, it is a modification, but cosmetically, it's just a stock-looking guitar. And then when I was going through it, you know, at the beginning, and I saw that these frets fit, I was like, you know what? First of all, they're official. Red Octane, like Red Octane made the guitar. Red Octane made these frets with the other guitar. I kept on calling them Red Octane, but they come out of the white wireless guitar for PlayStation 2. How I had an extra neck, I don't know. I've had quite a few guitars over the years. But yeah, so I figure that official frets, they feel really good, they're not sloppy. I probably would have been more upset if I used the SG frets that I was cutting, like, the tab, if you saw it, cutting all the crap off of. I think this was a better approach to this outlook, or to this look, rather. That I wanted SG-looking frets, you know, just the solid color instead of the black with the ring. Yeah, you know what, though? That's my final thoughts. I'm more than pleased. Show you there. My friend said he came over last night, and he's like, it just looks weird because everything's upside down. And I'm like, yeah, but not to me. When I'm looking at it, I can read it. All right, sorry. I got a call from my lawyer, so let's wrap this up. Final thoughts. I'm more than pleased with it. Hope you guys enjoyed it. I'm trying to be more thorough with my builds, and I figured, even though I literally wasn't going to do a video on this at all until I decided to put these in, I try to be thorough, like I said. And hopefully you enjoyed it. I enjoyed it. I enjoyed making it. I enjoy doing this stuff, guys. I appreciate that I've gotten quite a lot of love recently. It makes me more motivated to do it. And once I get done with all my personal projects, I'm going to have nothing to do. So commissions, you know, I wouldn't say start asking now, but if you guys need guitars, I make guitars, you know. So once I get done with all my personal stuff, you know, like I said, there'll be room for making more. Peace.